Now that we are about to reach the point of history, which the Sohei and Ikko Ikki gained the peak of their power, let's talk about their weapons and dress style. Firstly, the Ikko Ikki came from all classes, but were largely mobs of lower class peasants, mixed in with some of the samurai class of varying wealth that used and wore whatever they had on hand as armor or arms. One of the interesting historical exceptions was the Saika Ikki, based in Ota in Ki province, a mercenary group who supported the Ikki movement led by Saika Magoichi, who insisted on an all-arquebus army. His troops were made up of expert makers and users of the arquebus. Their town motto was, "Stand strong and do not forget," and they held Ota Castle. For the faces of the movement, the Sohei monks, having the wealth and status in Japanese society, had proper arms. But again, these varied depending on wealth or the temples they came from. The most famous weapon of the monks was the naginata, a Japanese-style glaive, a midway between the long-range close combat of a yari or long spear and a katana or sword, which made it decent for both attack and defense. That being said, many warrior monks were said to be proficient in many weapons, especially the well-known ones in Japanese society, like the bow and arrow made of rattan or bamboo called daikyu. The unique, so to speak, weapon of the monks was the tetsubo or kanabo, which was basically a club forged of solid iron, which was also used by samurai too, but not as popular. It might have been a weapon of choice for some monks as it could defeat an opponent without bloodshed, which kept to Buddhist ideals more, although not by a long shot. More rare was the arquebus, which the Sohei of Negoroji were experts in. Some monks were also able to afford horses and wore yoroi armor of the samurai, on top of which they wore their religious robes, usually white under a saffron yellow top layer, and of course their head cowl that was folded or tied to their head. For their feet, they wore tabi socks and geta, wooden clogs, or waraji, straw sandals. The banners used by the monks were adorned with Buddhist sayings such as Nenbutsu or Namu Amida Butsu. Now, catching up on the Sohei from the last video, the Onin War that was the stimulus of the Sengoku Jidai was the period where the monks became more militant again and reorganized themselves on a war footing, since the Onin War took place in Kyoto, unlike the Mongol invasions, which meant that the monks could not stay neutral to the conflict. Although the monks of Mount Hiei were still followers of the Tendai sect, the spiritual beliefs that led to the Ikko Ikki, Jodo Shinshu, spread far and wide and got a large amount of people to fight for their beliefs, the powerhouses of the movement being at Nagashima, Ishiyama Honganji, and in Mikawa province. The power of these Ikko Ikki movements attracting the attention of even great daimyo such as Oda Nobunaga due to the military, spiritual, and economic threat they posed to samurai rule. For example, economically, the Ishiyama, Honganji, and other Ikki strongholds laid across major trade routes. In fact, almost all the roads to the capital from the western part of the country was controlled by the Ikko Ikki or their allies. Add to their populist beliefs, giving them support from the ground up, meaning merchants were more willing to deal with the Ikko Ikki with more favor. Also, the territory the Ikko Ikki were in was in the way of Nobunaga's, as he wanted to take over those territories, and he could not possibly have allowed a hostile force behind his front lines. So that is more details of the Sohei and the Ikko Ikki. Join us next time for the eventual fate of the movement. Subscribe, comment, let me know what you think. Thank you very much. Till next word.